John chapter 6 tonight. Open your Bibles. You can hold a place in Isaiah 55 as well. So John chapter 6, Isaiah 55. I will visit 2 Peter 1. That was one I threw in last minute. So a couple places for you to get to in your Bible tonight. Just excited about this word. As we continue studying the book of John and John's purpose, we learned in the beginning that he wrote these things by the signs he put in this book that we would believe. These things were written that we would believe, John 20, 31 tells us, and that in believing, remember, you would have life in his name. And so we're finding this come again. Each time we go through another one of these signs, and today, camping in that area where Jesus talks to us and bids us to come to him and find life, and really the fullness of life that we find in him. And it's ever increasing as we grow to know him in this journey until we see him face to face. He knows that day. It is ever increasing. Amen? Amen. Let's go to him and pray. Father, we just come tonight. Thank you, God, that as the rain has come down and its purpose is there, Lord, this word tonight you've sent forth even ahead to us for a purpose tonight in our hearts. We don't want to miss a thing. And God, we ask humbly that you would open the eyes of our heart to see the things that are in your word by your Spirit. Father, we long for you. We long to understand more that we might know you more. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. So here we have John chapter 5 last week. We didn't get to meet, but you went through it in your study guide. And we have in John chapter 5 the sign that Jesus did, the healing of the paralytic. We jump from that sign to the beginning of chapter 6, and John gives us the next sign, which is the feeding of the 5,000. Now, between those two events, many events took place. Wiersbe points out in his commentary, you can write some of these down, and later in the week you can go back through and visit some of the events that took place between the healing of the paralytic and the feeding of the 5,000. Luke 6, 1 through 9, 10 describes some of those events, along with Mark 3, 1 through 6, 30. Then in Matthew 5 through 7, we see the Sermon on the Mount. And in Matthew 13, we see the parables of the kingdom. And all these things happened between the events in John 5, the healing of the paralytic, and John 6, the feeding of the 5,000. Not all recorded in John 6, but you can visit some of them in the other Gospels. And what we find is that this feeding of the 5,000 was such a large event, it's in all four Gospels. If you got through any of your study guide, you would have been able to visit one of our days. We had you look up each of those accounts and read through it a bit. If you didn't get a chance to do that, you can go back and do that this week or on our break because we're going to have a long enough break. Anything you didn't get to, go back and do. But you'll notice Matthew 14, Mark 6, Luke 9, and John 6 all have the account of the feeding of the 5,000. Such a great sign. In Mark 6, it paints a little more of the picture we see as you put all the Gospels together to hear the story and see what was happening. How did they get there? Why were they there? What were they maybe feeling at the time? And so in Mark 6, Jesus and his disciples had done much ministry. We were told Jesus had just sent out the 12. And he sent them out, he said, to preach that the people should repent, to cast out demons, and to anoint with oil to heal. So they were busy about much ministry. Days well spent. In Mark chapter 6 and in Matthew chapter 14, we find that not only were they doing much ministry, but they had received grieving news. And the news they had received was that John the Baptist, Jesus' cousin, the one who went to prepare his way, was beheaded. And he was killed. So the disciples come, and upon hearing this news, we find that that's when Jesus bids them to come with me and rest a while. So they had been busy, days well spent, and he says, come with me now. Let's go, and we're going to rest a while. In Luke 9, it actually says that Herod, the one that had beheaded John the Baptist, was now seeking Jesus. So the murderer is now seeking you. You can imagine. And maybe Jesus was foreshadowing his own call to the cross. But he bids his disciples to go and with him come away and rest a while. What do you do with a well-spent moment? You all today, some of you worked long day. You come tonight. You've had a well-spent day. Maybe you find on a day you've worked a double shift. Well spent. You're kind of at the end of yourself. And you've worked that double shift so much so you didn't even have time to eat that day. So you come to your end of your day, you haven't had time to eat, you're tired, and you decide, I'm going to plan just a little time to rest. I deserve it. Have you ever said, I deserve this. I deserve to rest. Have you been there? Yeah, I've been there. Come on, I deserve to rest. And what happens? What happens is the guests show up unexpected, but not just a couple of them come to your door. 5,000 come to your door. If it was me, I'd run the other way. Not Jesus. Not Jesus. Mark 6 says that he had compassion on them. They were like sheep. He saw them as sheep without a shepherd. Luke 9 says that he received them. Day well spent, they hadn't even eaten, and he received them. He spoke to them. He taught them about the coming kingdom of God. He gave them truth. It says he healed those who needed to be healed. He met their physical need, truth and grace, grace and truth. He gave them the truth of his word. He met their physical needs, but in Matthew chapter 14, we read that it was evening now, day well spent, now again, evening, and the disciples urged Jesus, send the people away. It's been long enough, and they need to go find something to eat. What's Jesus' response? We see in Matthew 14, no, you give them something to eat. You give them something to eat. God gives them a work to do. Don't you love that we see in John 6, Andrew and Peter, they bring this boy's lunch. Well, this lad's got 2 fish and 5 loaves. Here's what we got. So when God gives you a work to do, you give him what you got. And sometimes with that, we don't feel like it's enough. We don't feel like it's going to cut it, but we don't go based on what we feel like at the time. I'm going to pick up in John 6. Go with me there. We're going to start in verse 10. John 6, pick it up in verse 10. Let me read. Then Jesus said, make the people sit down. Now there was much grass in the place, and so the men sat down, in number about 5,000. And Jesus took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them to the disciples, and the disciples to those sitting down, and likewise of the fish, as much as they wanted. So when they were filled, he said to his disciples, gather up the fragments that remain, so that nothing is lost. Therefore they gathered them up and filled 12 baskets with the fragments of the 5 barley loaves which were left over by those who had eaten. Then those men, when they had seen the sign that Jesus did, they said, this is truly the prophet who has come into the world. Now, Jesus took what they gave, and notice it says, he took it and he had given thanks and he distributed it. He gave thanks. So when Jesus gives you a work to do, you give him what you got and you give thanks. And what's going to happen? But in his hands, he multiplies it. And he multiplied it. I cannot tell you how many times he's given me the work to do and it's before me. And I come and I'm like, yeah, all I got is this 2 fish and 5 loaves right here. I don't feel like it's going to cut it, Lord. I don't feel like it's enough. But thank you. And will you take it? And will you multiply it? A builder of my faith this last couple months, our pastor's heart, start a choir. And when he had that on his heart, he looked at me, he said, you're starting the choir. Okay, I'm going to start the choir. Lord, I don't know what I'm doing, but you know. And so we start the choir at Easter. It's amazing. And then we decide, you know, we never put it out to the church. So we're going to open it up to the church, and we're going to invite people to come to the audition. 2-3 months ahead, we set that date for the audition. And then 2 weeks before, we put our little announcement up on the screen. Sign up. Here's the link. And no one signs up because people don't sign up on these links that you're supposed to sign up on these days. And I think to myself, I didn't do what I should have done. I should have had a paper sign up in the lobby. People would have signed a paper. Maybe that's how we could have gotten people. And the Lord stopped me and he said, is this my work or yours? No, it's my vision I gave your pastor, and I'm going to bring the people. I said, okay, Lord, you're right. You are going to bring the people. Me, a little faith. Let me tell you what. That audition day comes, and that, guess what? We had no idea that our pastor was teaching that day on serving in his kingdom, and he does an invite for people to come forward at the end of the message to be prayed and filled with his spirit to go out and do the work. 50 people show up at that audition, and most of them came because of that message that day. Let me tell you, God has got the work he's going to do, the work and send the people. Well, then after the fact, we've got all these people to process, and I'm thinking, Lord, I don't know how we're going to do this. He said, if I'm going to do the work and I'm going to bring the people, you know I'm going to help you process them? You're right, Lord. Multiply the little we got. And that's what he wants to do in our life. So now, after the lesson for the disciples was the feeding of the 5,000. But we read in the word, their hearts were hard and they didn't understand it. Not completely. So he brings the examination. And the examination, fear or faith, what's going to win? Now, time's growing, day is going long. They didn't even have time to eat. Jesus protects his disciples and he sends them in the boat. He protects them because the crowd wants to take him and make him king. They're crazy. And he's saying, it's not my time yet. He didn't really say it all like that, but that's my paraphrase. And so they want to come make him king. And he's thinking, look, you all need to get in the boat and just go. So he sends them away to protect them. They get into the boat. And as it gets dark, starts to rain, kind of like tonight. Imagine you drove here in that. They were in a boat in that. And then the wind starts picking up, and they're struggling at the oar. They're struggling, and they're afraid. What I love is that Mark 6 tells us that he sees them. He's up on the mountain. He sent them in the boat. He went on the mountain to go pray to the Father. But he sees them. Now, when the storm comes up in our life, do we have faith to go past what we see? Do we have faith to know that we're still in his care? Or do we look at the storm and decide, here now Jesus sees them and he comes to them. And he comes walking on the water. Now, we don't read this in John 6, but it's in this account and right here that Peter, once they realize it's Jesus, he says, Jesus, tell me to come to you and I'll come. Jesus gives the word, come. Peter gets out of that water and he walks on the water. He gets out onto the water and he walks on the water until he sees the storm and the waves and he sinks because he's fearful and the fear comes in. And Jesus said to them, it's I am. Do not be afraid is what he told them. So this is the examination now. Is it fear or is it faith? The storm in your life he wants to use to produce, to bring you from fear to faith. Someone recently told my husband, you're going to walk on that storm. It's from him. He sees you in it. He cares for you in it. Okay, it's a lot easier said than done at the time, but I promise he sent the helper to help us, amen, to walk on the storm. He sees and he is Lord over the storm. That's what we trust in the trial in our life. All we see is the trial. We don't see past it, but our God, he sees past it. He sees you a year from now. He sees you 5, 10, 20 years from now. He sees past it, and he's Lord over that storm. Our light and momentary trials are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. You know how many times I had to memorize that verse and say it to myself time and time again, every trial that came. Okay, it doesn't feel like this, Lord, but this trial is light and momentary. I'd stand on the truth of the promise beyond what I feel, because it's not about what we feel. It's about our faith. And now, after the examination, Jesus addresses the crowd again because they come back for more. We're going to see why they came. Not only does he address them for what their real need is, but he gives them the answer to that need. We're going to see. Let's pick it back up. Let's go back to John chapter 6. I'm going to pick it up in verse 24. John chapter 6, verse 24. When the people therefore saw that Jesus was not there, he had left, he'd gone up on the mountain to pray to his Father. Take note of that. Nor his disciples, they also got into boats and they came to Capernaum, seeking Jesus. And when they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, Rabbi, when did you come here? Jesus answered them and said, Most assuredly I say to you, you seek me, underline it, not because you saw the signs, but because you ate of the loaves and were filled. Do not labor for the food which perishes, but for the food which endures to everlasting life, which the Son of Man will give you, because God the Father has set his seal on him. Now he addresses the crowd and he says, I know why you're seeking me. You had your bellies filled and you want more. But that food, yeah, bread will sustain you for a time. And then what happens? You got to eat more, right? It's not going to be for everlasting. But he's starting to talk to them in spirit now. And he gives them spirit-filled words. And he says, there's another kind of bread I'm going to talk to you about. That's the bread you need to labor for. And so he addresses their real need. They're laboring for food, and he says, don't labor for that food. Your real need is the spiritual hunger deep within you. You don't know it. And so it is with us. Because we can come to Jesus seeking many things. What are the things that we're seeking him for? I mean, maybe I need to pass the test this week in class. Lord, I can't even get past that exam. If you get me past that exam, then I'll... Or I need a job. God, I've been out of job. I've been out of work. I need a job. Or maybe I need a man. Whatever we come seeking him for, he'll answer those things at time. Maybe it's a physical healing. And it's okay that that leads us to him. But something beautiful we find as we seek him for that thing, we find the greater source of our sustenance, himself. And that's what we're going to look into tonight. Let's pick it back up in John 6. Let's go to verse 28. Then they said to him, What shall we do that we may work the work of God? Work the works of God. And so notice now he had said, hey, don't labor for this food, labor for that food. And they're saying, okay, labor, what's the works we're going to do? They're very interested in works. Now Jesus answered and said to them, This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he sent. Now he proclaims himself at that moment, God has sent me. Then they said to him, 29. Jesus answered and said to them, This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he sent. Therefore they said to him, But what sign will you perform that we may see it and believe you? What work will you do? They're very interested in works. They want to see before they believe. But isn't it interesting that God calls us to believe and then see? We're going to see later as we study John 11, when Jesus raises Lazarus, he says to Martha, Did I not say to you that if you would believe, you would see the glory of God? For us, it's the same. Faith is the evidence of things not seen. So it's what we don't see that we believe confidently in. The truth of his word to us, his promise to us that he's God. And that in that, if we believe, on the backside is where we're going to get to see. Not always here. Maybe it's not going to be till we're in eternity that we see. But he wants to call us to believe and then see. And so the people wanted to see Jesus. I want to jump over to verse 33 of John 6 as we continue through in the chapter. Verse 33, now Jesus continues to speak to them. He says, for the bread of God, now he's talking to them about believing, and they talked to him about manna, remember? They said, up in verse 30, what work will you perform? Sorry, then they go on in verse 31, our fathers ate the manna in the desert, and he gave them this bread from heaven. So they start asking Jesus about the sign Moses did to give them the supernatural bread. For 40 years, God fed them with it. But do you remember, Deuteronomy 8 talks about why he fed them, why he allowed them to hunger. First, he allowed their fathers to hunger to humble them. And then it said that it would teach them to trust him and believe. And that was why he gave them the manna. But now they ask about the sign. Manna, they're looking for a work. And now here's what Jesus tells them in verse 33. Now the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. That is the bread of God. Don't work for this bread that perishes. Work for this bread by believing in him who he sent. The bread, that the true bread, more than manna, is this true bread from heaven. And so we continue in verse 34 and 35. Then they said to him, Lord, give us this bread always. We don't have to keep coming back here to eat then. And they still didn't get it. And Jesus then says to them, verse 35, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me, underline that, shall never hunger. And he who believes in me shall never thirst. We're talking about a complete sustenance. Never hunger and never thirst. Because the things that we come seeking him for, we get that man, let me tell you what's going to happen. You're not going to feel the never hunger, never thirst. In fact, you might feel lonely again, even though you got that man. And you'll think, oh, I didn't think if I got the man, I'd feel lonely again. Doesn't fill. It doesn't satisfy like he wants to satisfy you. And so notice we underlined in that scripture, he who comes to me shall never thirst. Believing in him is a movement toward him. It's action. And so you believe in him, but that means there's going to be a great exchange because you're going to move toward him and you are going to give him your ways, your life. You're going to surrender to him. You're going to yield to him. And in return, you're going to take in who he is. We surrender the earthly things, the things we thought we hungered for, in exchange for the satisfaction that only comes from him. What are the things we hunger for? Acceptance, affection, love, attention. But maybe from the wrong source. All those things are things that we need in life. But if we look for it from the other sources, it's not the sustenance that fills us. Because whatever place we are in life may change. You're single today, you may be married tomorrow, but you're married today, you may be single tomorrow. That changes. One thing does not change. If you receive and you come to him, the bread of life, and believe in him and exchange and take from him the sustenance he wants to give you, then you will be filled. You won't hunger. You won't thirst. And so our hunger and thirst is only truly satisfied when we come to him. Spurgeon says, the coming here meant is performed by desire. Do you desire him? You spend time with the people you want to be with most. You'll make a point of it. You want to be with your friend, you're going to set an appointment for a lunch date. So desire him and set an appointment to be with him. I tell friends all the time, you know what? I know it's easy to say we're busy. We don't got time for his word or for prayer like Jesus went away to the Father to pray. Sometimes set a lunch date with him and then don't eat any food and partake of the bread of life. The word, the living word, his word be what you eat in that little appointment that you have. And watch your faith grow. Because our faith comes from hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Spurgeon continues to say, by assent, by prayer, by consent, by trust, that the coming is a trust. When I come to him, I yield to him and I give him my trust. I trust him completely with all of my life. And Spurgeon ends with obedience. Because when I come to him, I'm obeying his word. I'm going to walk in it. And by the help of his spirit, heed him. I want to pick it up in verse 45 of John 6. Verse 45 we'll skip down to. And so Jesus continues his dialogue with them back and forth as some complain. And he says, it is written in the prophets, and they shall be taught by God. Therefore, everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. Not that anyone has seen the Father except he who is from God. He has seen the Father. Most assuredly, I say to you, he who believes in me has everlasting life. I am the bread of life. He says it again. And notice he quotes here, they shall be taught of God. And as he makes this quote, he quotes from Isaiah 54, actually. That's where the quote comes from, Isaiah 54:13. They shall be taught of God. And he says, he who believes in me has everlasting life. Now here's the thing. These Pharisees that were questioning him, and even some who followed him, that we're going to find are going to turn away. They're searching the scriptures, but they miss who the scriptures are pointing to. Back in John 5 that we studied last week, verse 39 and verse 40, Jesus told them, you search the scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life. They thought they were doing right, but they were still so blind. These are they which testify of me, he said. But you are not willing to come. He's bid them to come. They were not willing to come his way. They wanted it what they thought was best, their way. You are not willing to come to me that you may have life. We're no different. We want to believe, but we want to believe our way. So if this man has made this religion over here and I seem to like that, that's the way to God. Or maybe I'll pick this one over here. But if it's anything different than what this gospel is about, it's not the way. It's not going to bring the everlasting life that he wants to give us. What profit is it to us? And so as he quotes here, and they shall be taught by God, I want to turn to Isaiah 55. He quotes in Isaiah 54, they shall be taught of God. And here's how God is going to teach them and write it on their heart. Listen to Isaiah. You can go there if you're there in your Bible, Isaiah 55. Now we're talking about coming, and Jesus is bidding them come. The very next chapter that he quotes from says, ho, everyone who thirsts, come. Come to the waters, and you who have no money, come, buy, and eat. Yes, come, buy wine and milk without money and without price. Why do you spend your money for what is not bread and your wages for what does not satisfy? Listen carefully to me and eat what is good, the bread of life. He says, and let your soul delight itself in abundance. Incline your ear and come to me. Hear, and your soul shall live, and I will make an everlasting covenant with you. The sure mercies of David indeed I have given him as a witness to the people. The Messiah, Christ, the bread of life, a leader and a commander for the people, surely you shall call a nation you do not know, and nations who do not know you shall run to you because of the Lord your God and the Holy One of Israel, for he has glorified you. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way. It's the exchange when you come. You put back the old way. And the unrighteous man, his thoughts, it's no longer our way of thinking. It's taking on his way of thinking. Let him return to the Lord, and he will have mercy on him and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are my ways your ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts your thoughts. For as the rain comes down and the snow from heaven, and do not return there, but they water the earth and make it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish what I please. It has a purpose, his word. This bread of life, the living word, has a purpose in his relationship with you. His word, in what you're reading and studying, has a purpose in your life today. And it shall prosper in the thing for which I sent it. And so he bids them to come. And we find in the coming, we assimilate him into our being. I'm going to read to you from John 56, 6:56 and 57. Let's go there. John 6, 56 and 57. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me. Now Jesus gives an even more difficult teaching. Okay, the bread of life. Now he says, you're going to eat my flesh and drink my blood. Now this does not mean that the little holy sacrament is actually his flesh and blood. These are spiritual words. He's giving a spiritual meaning of believing in him. You are spiritually going to eat my flesh and drink my blood, he says. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me. We actually come into being with him, and I in him, we become one. And as the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so he who feeds on me, that's a continual feeding, will live because of me. And so it's not just a one time I came to Jesus. No, continually coming to him. Continually partaking of him. Feeding on his flesh. You're partaking of him. I'm going to read to you from 2 Peter 1. You can turn there if you've got it. Find it. Peter's, then John's. 1 Peter, 2 Peter, here we are. 2 Peter 1, listen, verse 2. Grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and our Lord and of Jesus our Lord, as his divine power has given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of him who called us by glory and virtue, by which have been given to us exceedingly great and precious promises. And here's what the promises are. That through these, you may be partakers of the divine nature. That means as we partake of him, you are partakers of his divine nature. You're going to go feed on him. You know what's going to happen? You're going to become like his nature. And thanks be to God who rescues me from this body of death, Paul said, because I know who I was, the worst of sinners. And I know who I still am today and where I struggle in my flesh. But the hope and the promise is as we follow him and just come, when he bids us come, when we come and we make the time, we go in prayer. We spend time to assimilate his word and partake of the living, true bread of life, his word. As we partake of him, we're going to become partakers of his divine nature. We're exchanging it. It's the exchange. We're going to give him the old ways of my thinking that are not helping me. Be ready for it. Even when you think you're obedient, if you ask him, show me where I'm not, he will. He's faithful. Gently, he'll show you. He'll correct you. And he'll give you his divine nature. And we take that on and we partake of him. And so we continue in John 6, 61 through 63 as we close. Great. Just enough time. When Jesus knew in himself that his disciples complained about this hard teaching, eat my flesh, drink my blood, he knew they complained within themselves, and he said to them, does this offend you? What has he said to you that offends you? Because it's hard for you to follow in it. It's hard to crucify the flesh. When he said, pick up your cross daily and follow me, do you think that's going to be an easy task? Why does he say the road is narrow? Few find it. Does it offend you? There may be things that offend you. But he asks the question, and then he says, what then if you should see the Son of Man ascend where he was before? It is the Spirit who gives life. You can't walk in the flesh and find life. You've got to make the exchange. You've got to give up. You've got to surrender. You've got to yield. He'll help us do it. He will help us do it. It's the Spirit who gives life. The flesh profits nothing. What a waste of time. 1 Corinthians says you could surrender your body to the flames. You could go down. If you did it without love, it's for nothing. That was a work of the flesh. It profited nothing. But with Christ, by the Spirit, walking in the Spirit, God brings life. And he wants to use you. He wants to use the life in you to share, to be the light, the light of men. The words that I speak to you, he says, they're spirit and they're life. They're hard teachings to understand, and sometimes we don't understand them. God, I don't quite get this yet. You need to teach me and show me what this is by your Spirit. And trust me, he will. What do we put our energy into believing that is a waste of time? There could be a lot that we're toiling after, but we don't want to be found there because that's a waste of time. God, stop me in my tracks if I'm working the arm of flesh. I want to walk by the power of your Spirit. And so as we close in verse 66 to 69, from that time, many of his disciples went back and they walked with him no more. They followed for a while, but when the teaching got hard, it didn't feel good to follow it. Maybe it was too much to give up for them. They turned away. And then Jesus said to the 12, do you also want to go away? Why does he ask them the question? To solidify their faith. And I love Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Also, we have come to believe and know that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. If you're not coming toward him, what are you walking away to? What's the thing that you so have to hold on to like these Pharisees because they thought they were righteous? It was a self-righteousness. They missed the very bread of life before them. God was right in front of them. They did not see it. If we're not coming toward him, we're going the other way. And maybe we need to ask him, Father, what is it that I need to exchange in my life for your life to partake, to feed? Because he wants to be your everything. That's how much he loves you. He wants you to want just him and no other thing. He wants you to want him more than anything else. So he says to you, come. Let's pray. And so, Father, thank you for these that came tonight to hear your word. We come tonight because we're hungry for you, God. Whether it was rain or whatever else it was, we came. Because this place where we sit in you, abiding with you, in your word with you, there's such a peace in you, Jesus. There's so much life in you. And so, God, I pray, Father, forgive us for running after the things that we think we have to run after that are important to us. The things we think we hunger for, the things we think we long for. We lay them down and we ask, God, that you would give us the ability to come and to abide with you. God, and as we exchange and yield and surrender to you and give you the ways and old ways of thinking, that we'd partake of your divine nature, we'd become more like you. Father, thank you for that hope, that precious promise. And so, Spirit, do your work in us. We humble ourselves before you and ask that you, God, would teach us. God, lead us now as we go into group time. Use that time, I pray, that you'd fill us with your Spirit as we speak to one another and edify one another what we've learned from your word. In Jesus' name, amen.